Wow. Terima kasih ke Pak Bill. Hatur nuhun. So I just say in Sundanese that thank you. yeah, it's our fraud. I can't stand here. And then, yeah, we want to say that we are, what is it? Yes, actually, we are a little bit nervous here because it's first time we met with you all here, and then it's, yeah, I heard many news from, what is it, Emma, it's in here has the great union and then great government, and then, yeah. Yeah, anyway, I want to tell about, I want to explain a little bit about the, what is it, asbestos in Indonesia. So if you, I know many people here will say that asbestos is danger, and then many people here know about it. But if you come to Indonesia, even to university, even to the government, they will have another opinion. Asbestos is safe there because they will thought that what asbestos product is different with the others. They use the asbestos white, so it's safe. They will have opinion like that one. So, yeah, I mean, we have a different here. I mean, if you talk to the government, if you talk to the, even to the medical expert there, they have an argument like that. So that's one of big challenge in Indonesia to, what is it, on the campaigns on the ban asbestos in Indonesia. I think not only in Indonesia, but in Asia, mostly many, what is it, government, many, what is it, researcher or medical expert, same like that. So I want to say if asbestos danger in here and made many people die in here, so I think in Asia also, but the victim in Asia, in Indonesia, still visible. So I believe in the, what is it, because we campaigns on the, what is it, and believe that asbestos is danger, and then we have to ban asbestos, not only in Indonesia, not only in Australia, but in the world. So we have to make a global movement to ban asbestos. So this is about the Indonesian, where is it, asbestos in Indonesia. Indonesia import, based on the data of the government, since 1950. So in the last, in 2015, Indonesia import around 120,000 metric tons. In Indonesia, we don't have any asbestos mining. So all product, all raw material is import. Mostly is from Russia, from China, Kazakhstan. The last is from, where is it, Brazil. But Brazil in 2017 is not export anymore to Indonesia. And also Canada, 2012, the last import to Indonesia. And almost, where is it, 90% the raw material of asbestos that using for the construction, that used for the asbestos roof, cement, asbestos cement roof. And then that manufacturing on the 27 factory in Indonesia. So we have a lot of import asbestos, and then we will see the, Bono will tell about the working condition in the asbestos manufacturing, asbestos factory. It's very, very bad. And then, but until now, no has a victim. The government didn't has any data about how many workers get the asbestos-related disease. So many challenging about it, maybe because the many medical, no has a doctor who know about the asbestos, and maybe also about the facilities in the hospital. So also the, about the OSH policy. If you see the OSS policy in Indonesia, that's too old, I think, and then that's around 1970. That's almost, 50 years ago. And then, yeah, you can imagine. And if someone who worked on the asbestos factory and got lung disease or lung problem and go to the doctor will said it's TB. Always like that. The doctor didn't try to connect with the working condition or about the related with the occupational disease or etc. So why the occupational disease in Indonesia the number is the government didn't has any data about it, including about the asbestos issue. This is the industry map industry in about the where is it factory in Indonesia. So mostly the factory asbestos factory is in Java area, only one in Sumatra. I want to talk about the PT Bakri building industry. I think some Indonesians know about who's Bakri, yeah, the richest man, and then who has the political power in Indonesia. And actually, he has the Bakri, has the asbestos factory. And this factory, actually, in 1980s, the name is James Hardy, Indonesia. So I try to track the history. Actually, when the Australian has a big movement to ban asbestos in here, fight with the James Hardy, and then Jim Hardy moved to Indonesia. And yeah, you know. And not only Jim Hardy actually, but we can see the PT Siamindo Trigraha Silindo. That's actually the Korean company. That Korean company is moved to Indonesia in 90s. So in 90s, in Korea has a movement. The union has a movement to ban asbestos in South Korea. And they, when they have a ban, they move to Indonesia. And also in Siamindo Concrete product in Karawang, where Subono work there, is that company is a foreign company. That Siam, that mean is a Thai. So the big shareholder is Siam Cement. Siam Cement in Thailand is not use asbestos anymore. But in Indonesia, they use use asbestos in Indonesia. I thought it's like when we ban here, one country ban, the industry will move to another country and will keep running like that. And then so if we didn't have a global movement in to ban asbestos, the capital, the asbestos factory will keep run to the country who still legalize asbestos, I think. This is the product, the importation of the, asbestos product to Indonesia. So, still after 2012, the importation number is decreasing, but still a lot. It's decreasing because the Canadian stopped import to Indonesia. And then this is the biggest country, Russia, Brazil, and China. That's the biggest country which import to Indonesia. And then this is the number of the worker who work on the asbestos factory here, increasing. Actually, the number is 2,000. 2,000 worker is that's permanent worker. But in the asbestos factory, many of them is contract workers. So we calculate is around 4,000 workers who work in the asbestos factory. And then around 18 workers who work on the, industry related with the asbestos like that. So why the asbestos industry in Indonesia still keep running and keep strong? Because no tax for the when someone or company want to import to Indonesia asbestos, want to import asbestos to Indonesia, is free tax, so it's easy. And then the regulation also. So because the government still legalized the white asbestos, the crystal tile, and then also we calculate. The market in Indonesia is huge, and then if we refer to the government statistic, almost more than 10% the resident housing in Indonesia use asbestos roof. How about the working condition in asbestos factory? If you ask to people there who work in the asbestos factory, they get the wages, cheap wages. They work on the long time, long working hour. They working not has the security job, and then the company will still propaganda. Where is it like asbestos is cheap, easy, and blah blah blah. You know. This is the challenging of the ban asbestos campaigns in Indonesia. The first is about the information. Not only lack information, but also wrong information. Like I said in the first time, that when you ask to the people, do you know about the asbestos? Many people didn't know. And do you know about that asbestos is dangerous? They didn't know. And then it company and then some of the prolobic asbestos will thought that asbestos white is safe. So that's our big fight on the provide the right information in Indonesia. So we provide some website now and then public campaigns about that asbestos to provide the right information to the public about it. And then the other problem is about the diagnosis and doctor. Like Bono later will be told about that his friend got the lung disease. His friend worked in the asbestos factory and dying because asbestos dying because lung disease. But seldom no doctor thought it's related with the asbestos. So I think when we visit to Brisbane and then to Sydney last week, we talk about it. And then, okay, if you have an expert in here, a doctor, I think it's good opportunity to share about the knowledge about how to diagnose asbestosis to the local doctor in Indonesia, I think. And then the third is about the victim. Many company or many people, government people will tell to us, if asbestos is danger, where's the victim? No, we didn't found, actually. We didn't know. So it's our challenging. So in 2017, we do the medical assessment independently, and then has a 20 worker voluntary do the medical assessment with us, and then from the 20 worker has a 10 worker who diagnoses asbestosis. From the 10 people, from the 10 worker, only one who get the compensation. Why only one? Because if someone get the occupational disease, so the worker have to report to the company and then have to get approved from the company. That based on the regulation. So it make the worker hard. Who's the company will approve that the worker get the occupational disease. So this is the one challenging in Indonesia about the regulation, how to approve get the approval from the company related with the occupational disease. So that's another challenge in Indonesia. But it's history from Indonesia. I mean, last year we got the, one worker get the compensation and related with the asbestos disease. And then we have we're trying to organizing the journalists, and then we're trying to blow up this case. And then, so now many stakeholders want to meet with us from the Indonesian Ben Asbestos Network to how to decreasing the importation, and then how to make the people aware about the danger of asbestos. So another issue is about we found the victim, and then one victim already diagnosis, and then I think we have idea that the victim have to speak up, and then the victim have to show that they are get the asbestos, and then no one another people don't the victim. Bono will talk about how we organizing the victim group in Indonesia, and then I think for me that's it, and then Bono will explain more about how the working condition, and then how the union organizing, and then how the victim group trying to speak up and fight for their rights. Thank you very much.
Selamat malam kawan-kawan. Sebelum saya menceritakan kondisi di pabrik asbes, terima kasih Pak Menteri tadi sudah datang. Satu kebanggaan buat saya bisa ketemu langsung. Nama saya Subono. Saya pernah bekerja di pabrik asbes selama 14 tahun. Hari ini saya aktif di Serikat sebagai Sekretaris Jenderal di Federasi Serikat Buruh Kerakyatan Indonesia. Selama saya bekerja 14 tahun, saya tidak pernah mendapatkan informasi apapun tentang apa itu asbes dan apa dampak bahaya asbes bagi kesehatan. Ya, hingga di tahun 2013, saya diajak oleh teman-teman Leon, Bang Darisman, dan kawan-kawan, saya diperkenalkan dengan di satu acara bahwa ini asbes berbahaya, dan kebetulan waktu saya hadir di tahun 2013 juga kita melakukan pemeriksaan secara terpisah. Sebetulnya di perusahaan setiap tahun ada pemeriksaan kesehatan, tapi tidak ada informasi apapun juga dari perusahaan tentang hasil dari pemeriksaan itu. Dan ketika kami meminta hasil pemeriksaan itu, banyak syarat-syarat yang harus dikeluarkan oleh kita dengan syarat macam-macam begitu, dan itu menurut perusahaan itu hak perusahaan karena perusahaan yang melakukan pemeriksaan. Ya, dari 10 orang yang diperiksa waktu itu ada 2 orang yang diindikasi saluran paru-parunya rusak, dan salah satunya adalah saya. Ini kondisi tempat saya bekerja, ini di bagian produksi, dan itu asbes, teman-teman, waktu membongkar asbes dari kontainer sangat panas dan berdebu. Dan pastinya keselamatan kerjanya tidak ada jaminan yang pasti. Nah, ini asbes ketika mesin kami rusak dan kami bongkar begitu. Dan kita sudah terbiasa makan minum di sana ketika istirahat karena tidak ada informasi apapun mengenai bahayanya asbes, dan bahkan sering nggak pakai sarung tangan kita mengeluarkan dari mesin. Ya, ini tadi yang mesin yang untuk menggiling ini. Ini memori foto saya dengan kawan-kawan pada awal kami bekerja di yang di garis merah itu. Kawan saya, dia meninggal di tahun 2016. Dia dulu bekerja di bagian fiber storage, itu gudang asbesnya, asbes yang dari kontainer tahun 99. Kalau kalian lihat di yang di garis kuning itu teman-teman saya yang saluran paru-parunya memang bermasalah. Kalau yang pegang gitar itu saya masih. Ini kami melakukan pemeriksaan terpisah yang tadi untuk ya setelah kita diskusi dengan kawan-kawan, kita perlu ada seberapa yang apa debu asbes yang memang ada di udara, kita melakukan secara terpisah dan kita lakukan secara tersembunyi sambil kita bekerja. Ya, kami juga melakukan training. Ini foto setelah saya tahun 2016 saya ke Australia. Dulu kita tidak tahu bahwa asbes itu berbahaya. Dan tadi seperti tadi tempat kita bisa ngopi, makan dan ya ternyata perlakuan asbes sangat ketat begitu. Seperti harus pakai sarung tangan, harus seperti astronot begitu. Dan ya apa kami juga melakukan training-training kepada kawan-kawan tentang bahayanya dampak asbes bagi kesehatan. Mungkin lebih dari 5 kawan saya yang di perusahaan meninggal sakit karena saluran paru-paru. Ada security yang meninggal di pabrik juga dan kami menginisiasi untuk membentuk namanya perkumpulan korban K3. Kita beri nama pejuang K3. Isinya bukan hanya korban yang sekarang mengalami sakit, tapi teman-teman yang juga kecelakaan kerja. Ada satu dari kawan kita, samping saya itu tangannya terputus karena dia bekerja dan dia bergabung di pejuang K3. Itu kawan saya yang tadi diceritakan dari Risman, Pak Sriyono, dia berhasil dan mendapatkan kompensasi dan minta doanya hari ini saat tadi dapat informasi bahwa Pak Sriyono sedang sakit dan dia sedang dirawat. Di pejuang K3, kami memang korban. Tapi jangan pernah menganggap bahwa kami itu korban. Tapi hari ini saya tidak mau disebut korban. Hari ini saya berjuang dan saya harus memperjuangkan tentang kondisi hari yang harus lebih baik ke depan. Ya, ini gambar ketika kami mengkampanyekan tentang asbes di publik, di agenda-agenda di May Day, di WMD. Ya, di WMD kita mengkampanyekan bahwa asbes memang berbahaya dan harus stop penggunaan asbes di Indonesia. Mungkin hari ini masih kecil, dulu di awal-awal tahun 2013 hanya mungkin Serbuk dengan Lion yang mengkampanyekan, tapi hari ini sudah ada beberapa serikat yang sudah ikut terlibat dan kami di Konfederasi KBBI juga mendorong untuk selalu mengkampanyekan asbes dilarang di Indonesia. Serbu juga ikut di konferensi di apa ada di Unrof, ada juga di Siben dan membangun jaringan-jaringan untuk terus mendorong bahwa memang asbes bukan hanya stop di Indonesia saja tapi juga di Kamboja, di Vietnam dan di Myanmar. Kami juga mendorong ke pemerintah untuk melakukan kebijakan untuk merubah kebijakan bahwa pertama kali datang ke pemerintah bilang dan bilang bahwa dokter dari pemerintah bilang bahwa asbes yang dipakai Indonesia habis putih dan aman. Dan itu waktu tahun 2013. Di tahun 2016 kita juga datang lagi ke pemerintah bahwa ini sudah ada korbannya. Dan baru mereka tetap masih belum bilang bahwa ini bahaya, tapi masih oke. Kalau ada korban, kita akan diskusikan dan ya begitu pemerintah hari ini. Ya, saya tahu bahwa pelarangan asbes di Indonesia tidak mudah. Saya berharap ada dukungan dari kawan-kawan untuk mengusir dan stop asbestos di Indonesia dan mungkin di dunia, bukan hanya di Indonesia. Karena yang saya tahu adalah perusahaan bukan hanya membayar upah murahnya pekerja, tapi pastinya akan membunuh generasi kita ke depan. Saya sangat bangga bisa berada di tengah kawan-kawan untuk menceritakan kondisi hari ke depan, kondisi perusahaan tempat teman-teman kami bekerja, Dan saya sangat senang kemarin sudah ketemu dengan kawan-kawan yang lain juga, dan banyak sekali bekal buat saya nanti akan saya sampaikan di Indonesia, dan saya sangat bangga bisa berjuang bersama kawan-kawan. Terima kasih, selamat malam.